Now, let's take a look at it at this example here. In this example, it says, consider the titration of 75 mLs of 0.0300 molar H3C3O3. Here, it has a Ka of 4.1 times 10 to the negative 3, with 12 mLs of 0.0450 molar KOH, and I ask you, calculate the pH. All right, first of all, we should know what KOH is. KOH is a strong base. That goes without saying that we should know that. Next, what we're going to say here is this compound. This compound has H, a nonmetal, and it has oxygen. So it's an oxyacid. And remember, we do the math. If we subtract oxygens by hydrogens, for it to be a strong oxyacid, we need a minimum of two oxygens left. When we do the math, we have three oxygens minus three hydrogens. We have nothing left. So it's a weak oxyacid. And even if you didn't know that, you should realize it's weak because its Ka value is less than one. You always use that as the fallback because sometimes they may not give it to you and they might just ask you what can be done with this type of compound. You have to be able to identify that it's a weak acid. All right, so we have a weak species, we have a strong species, so we have to use an ICF chart. Now, number one thing, so each thing that I say, an ICF chart has much more detail involved. So be careful with everything I'm giving you guys. So write them down precisely. So when we're dealing with an ICF chart, whatever is strong has to always be a reactant. So we have a strong base, so that has to be our reactant. Now, we're gonna say bases naturally attack what? The mortal enemy, I guess, chemical enemy of a base is an acid. So this strong base has to react with the weak acid. Okay, so our weak acid is on the same side with the strong base. So first, remember, whatever is strong has to be a reactant. Whatever it is, it attacks its opposite. Since the strong base is a reactant, what do bases attack? Bases attack acids. So the weak acid has to be next to it as a reactant. Now, since we're dealing with a strong species, we no longer have double arrows. We have a single arrow going forward. Now, remember that the acid is going to give away an H+, and that H+ will go to the OH- within the base to give us water. And then what's left, we're going to have K+, which is going to react with H2C3O3-. Together they give us that compound. We're going to say ICF. Now, just remember, in an ICF chart, we only care about three things. We only care about whatever is strong. We only care about the weak acid. And we only care about conjugate base. Those are the three things we only focus on in an ICF chart. The fourth thing, we never look at it. We just ignore it. And in this particular example, the fourth thing happens to be a liquid, water. Just like in an ice chart, an ICF chart ignores liquids and solids. But even if it wasn't water, we'd still ignore it because in an ICF chart, we only care about what is strong, the weak acid, and the conjugate base. Now, next thing we're going to say is, what are the units in an ICF? The units have to be in moles. So what we're going to do here is, remember the word of means multiply. And remember, moles can be found if you take your molarity and multiply it times your liters. So these mLs, divide them by 1,000. These mLs, divide them by 1,000. Multiply them with their molarities. When we do that, we're going to get 0.00225 moles. And remember, how did I get that number? I just divided the 75 mLs by 1,000 and then multiplied that by 0.0300 molar. And it gives me that many moles. The base, divide 12 mLs by 1,000. Those liters, you multiply times the molarity, and it gives you moles. I don't give you any information on the conjugate base, so initially it's zero. Okay, now, an ICF chart, like I've been saying, is much more detailed, and it's very different from an ice chart. What we're going to do now is we're only going to pay attention to the reactant side. Only pay attention to the reactant side. Remember that the smaller moles will try to neutralize the larger amount of moles. So the smaller moles, which are these moles, will try to neutralize the larger moles, these moles. It's going to take, the strong base is going to take all of itself and try to neutralize as much of the weak acid as it can. At the end, you have no more strong base, and you're still going to have some weak acid left. Now remember, the first law of thermodynamics says matter is neither created nor destroyed. So it's okay. The weak acid is decreasing by this much, but that's fine because it's not really getting destroyed. It's just getting reshaped into a new form. So if our weak acid decreases by that much, its conjugate will increase by the same amount. So the conjugate over here increases by the same amount. Okay, so just remember, much more detailed. Look at the reactant side. Whichever moles are smaller, they will neutralize, try to neutralize the larger moles. So they will take all of themselves and try to subtract it from the larger moles. So just remember that one principle. And remember, whatever the reactant decreases by, it's okay because its conjugate will increase by the same amount. Bring this down. Now what you need to realize here is, what do you have at the end? At the end you have conjugate base left and you have weak acid left. Weak acid, conjugate base, what does that give us? That gives us a buffer. And remember, if you have a buffer, just use the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation to find pH. So remember, for Henderson-Hasselbalch, pH equals pKa plus log of conjugate base over weak acid. So negative log of Ka plus log of the conjugate base, what we have left, over the weak acid. Punch that all into your calculator and you should get back 1.89 for your pH. So again, an ICF chart is very detail oriented. So make sure you've paid attention to all the steps that I've talked about. And we know that we should have a buffer at the end because remember, what's one of the ways to create a buffer? Mixing a weak acid and a strong base. Weak acid, strong base. As long as the weak acid is larger in initial amount than the strong base, you will have a buffer at the end. So the theory we learned earlier, we're now seeing it applied to using calculations. ICF charts, like I've been saying, are much more detail oriented. So we're going to be doing a lot of them. Pay attention to all the methods that we're using. Now that you guys have seen this one, I want you to attempt to do the next one on your own. Don't worry about it. If you get stuck, come back, click on the explanation video. You'll see a video of me explaining how best to approach this problem. And remember the principles that we talked about. If we have a weak acid or base reacting with something strong, it's going to be an ICF. In this example, we have HBr, which is a strong acid, mixing with acetic acid, which is a weak acid, and its conjugate base has one less H. Here, Ka of acetic acid is actually this number. I forgot to give it to you. But just remember, that's the Ka of acetic acid. Weak acid conjugate base are both weak. So we have two weak things mixing with a strong thing. So we know we should do an ICF. Remember, strong thing has to be what? What side does it have to be on? And from there, follow along all the things that we talked about earlier to solve this question. Come back, click on the explanation button to see what answer I get and if it matches up with yours. Good luck, guys.